Let's finish off our treatment of DNA replication by discussing what happens at the end of the linear eukaryotic chromosome. There's a special problem posed by the properties of polymerases and the end replication of linear chromosomes. So let's consider that. As you know, eukaryotes all have linear chromosomes, not circular bacterial chromosomes. And let's consider what is happening here at the replication fork, as the replication fork moves to the end of a chromosome, shown in this little square here, and now blown up and at higher magnification here. And schematically speaking, we can see very easily how on the leading strand, as DNA replication proceeds, this blue strand is being synthesized upon the green strand, as replication proceeds 5 prime to 3 prime, we go down to the end, the very end of the chromosome without any trouble. Continuous leading strand replication. But because of the lagging strand mode of synthesis, in which short RNA primers are synthesized at the replication fork extended by DNA polymerase, the primers being removed by a DNA polymerase and then ligase sealing the gaps between that are left in the sugar phosphate backbone, we have a problem when we get to the end of the chromosome, in that the last primer, RNA primer, when removed, will leave, down below here, we can see that that will leave a missing piece of DNA. Why? Because there's no DNA polymerase to come along and synthesize new DNA replacing the RNA primer that is chewed away. Because there's no replication fork further along the pathway. So this last primer is removed by RNases and not replaced with nucleotides, with DNA nucleotides, with deoxyribonucleotides, so that we have a small gap there, and that's because there's no more replication fork down here to synthesize a new Okazaki fragment. So we're left with this truncated piece of DNA. Now consider this blue piece of the end of the chromosome, which will be serve as a template for replication in the next round of DNA replication. So let's come down here to the very bottom here and look at what happens when this shortened shortened DNA molecule serves as a template, I should say. Well, you will have continuous DNA replication on this. It will be a leading strand for replication in our example. But replication will end, of course, at where the end of the template is. And so what we will end up with is a chromosome which is slightly shorter. And this will happen for other ends of the chromosomes too. When we look at the second round of replication here, when this one serves as a template, we will shorten the end of the chromosome by a bit. Now, the end of chromosomes are known as telomeres, and this problem of end replication results in telomere shortening over a number of cell generations. So soon the population of cells becomes dominated by cells that have shorter and shorter telomeres as cell divisions, DNA replications proceed, and daughter cells are generated. And that is a problem because the chromosomes then are being shortened and will eventually lose genetic material that codes for genes. Now, telomeres do not encode genes for the most part. There's no coding DNA found at the ends. They serve merely to stabilize the end of the chromosome. But it's very important that the telomere maintain a certain length, a substantial length, in order for the cell cycle to proceed and cells to divide. When the telomeres become short enough, cells enter senescence. They are triggered to senesce and die. So when you have a dividing population of cells, you must have a way to extend the telomeres and so that they will not reach a shortening critical point and cause the cells to senesce and die. And the enzyme that is responsible for elongating telomeres, keeping them long, to get around this end shortening problem, that enzyme is called telomerase or telomerase, however you want to pronounce it. And telomerase is a very interesting enzyme in that it is composed of both RNA and protein. And there is an RNA component to the enzyme that is complementary, that has RNA nucleotides that are complementary to the repeated sequences of DNA found at the telomere ends. So chromosomal telomeres have repeats of a particular short sequence repeated over and over again at the telomere. And as these become shorter, of course, these repeats are removed as cell divisions proceed and the end replication problem comes into play. But telomerase here, shown the protein part shown schematically as a blue ellipse here, and the RNA component of the telomerase shown in gold, the RNA component of telomerase has ribonucleotides that are complementary to the repeat found in the DNA telomere, and therefore will hydrogen bond with it in a Watson-Crick double helical type of fashion. And that serves actually as a lead, that provides for a leading strand template, if you will, because now we can synthesize DNA 5 prime to 3 prime using the information present in the RNA as a template. And the RNA, remember, is a part of the telomerase enzyme. So that provides a template upon which DNA synthesis can occur. And telomerase, in fact, is a DNA polymerase, having an enzymatic activity that will synthesize DNA in the 5 prime to 3 prime direction. But the DNA polymerase activity of telomerase, it uses the RNA component of the telomerase as the template upon which DNA polymerization will occur. So there are two main functions to the telomerase enzyme. One, the template RNA that is complementary to the repeat sequences found in telomeres so that it will bind there, and the polymerase activity that is found in the telomerase enzyme as well that will add new nucleotides extending the length of the telomere. Now, I've mentioned that the telomeric DNA of eukaryotic chromosomes consists of repeated sequences, and it does. And that allows the complementary RNA of the telomerase enzyme to provide a template upon which DNA synthesis can occur, and then the telomerase can move because of the repeated DNA sequences. It can now move and anneal to sequences of DNA that it has just synthesized. So it can jump down and allow its 3' nucleotides to Watson-Crick base pair with the 5' with the 3' most nucleotides that it has have just been synthesized on the strand that the telomerase is elongating. So it would jump down and synthesize the next repeat. So that would create a long stretch of repeated DNA at the telomere end, which can then be synthesized, can be filled in on the opposite strand by regular DNA replication. So the telomeres then are extended by telomerase. And telomerase is essential if in a cell population that is going to be continually dividing. Now, in most adults, in most adult mammals, humans, for example, most of our cell populations are not dividing. They are quiescent, and only when we lose cells by being sloughed off, by dying, are they replaced by stem cells that continually divide. So stem cells need to have an active telomerase enzyme in them. But where else, what pathology do we find dividing cells? We find dividing cells that have lost their normal controls on cell proliferation in cancers. And in cancers, the telomerase enzyme has been turned on. So all cancers have active telomerase because all cancers are continually dividing. In cells which don't continually divide, they do not synthesize active telomerase because their telomeres will reach a certain point and then the cell will die by natural causes as intended. So telomerase activity has been a target for possible cancer therapies because if you can block telomerase activity, you can, in dividing cancer cells, you can block elongation of their telomeres and thereby allow the end replication problem to come into play for that cell population, and eventually the telomeres will become short enough that the cells will senesce and die after a certain number of cell generations. So knocking out the telomerase activity is actually a very hot area in cancer research. Now what I'd like to do is move on to taking a re-look at the actual chemistry of DNA polymerization, the actual what happens at the as a new nucleotide is added to a growing DNA chain. We've seen it before, but I'd like you to show it to you in a little more detail now. What we're looking at here is a DNA polymerase of a bacterial virus, the T7 bacteriophage. And this is a very simple DNA polymerase, and for that reason is a nice system to study the structure-function relationship of DNA polymerases in general. And what we have here is a polymerase proper shown in purple, consisting mostly of alpha helices, but there's a beta sheet that we'll examine in a minute. And then a subunit, which actually serves as the processivity factor for this polymerase, for this phage polymerase that replicates the bacteriophage genome when an infection of bacteria takes place. And this structure of protein was captured in the process of adding a new nucleotide to a growing DNA chain by Dublé et al. In a paper published in the journal Nature in 1998. And this enzyme, again, has been captured in the process of adding a new nucleotide, shown in aqua here. And what we should have is the primer strand in light gray and the template strand in dark gray. So this is a very nice system to look at the addition of a new nucleotide in terms of the chemistry that is occurring in the addition process. So we have the polymerase proper again shown in purple, and let's just look at the polymerase and forget about the processivity factor for the time being. So this is the polymerase. And like many DNA polymerases, there are three domains, a green domain, a red domain, and a purple domain that show we can represent that to a palm with a thumb, palm, and fingers. So it's like a hand. And that hand will clasp DNA in it. And as you can see, the hand domain here, green thumb, blue palm, and red fingers clasp the DNA. And this gold domain down here is an exonuclease domain that we don't need to consider for the purposes of looking at polymerization. But you can see that this hand-shaped domain has clasped DNA and is synthesizing a new strand in light gray off a template strand shown in dark gray. And the polymerase domains are mostly alpha helices, as I've said, but there are some beta sheets as well. And especially if you look at the palm of the hand domain, of the polymerase domain, the palm really, there's a beta sheet there that serves as the flat base of the palm that clasps DNA. So let's focus in on the DNA that is being synthesized now and examine DNA synthesis. Here we have the template strand in dark gray, the primer strand in light gray, and the last nucleotide that has been added, we've colored yellow, and the incoming nucleotide that is going to be added, we show in aqua. So if we look at the last added nucleotide that has been added, there is a free 3' hydroxyl group shown in red that exists, of course, at the 3' end. And that is juxtaposed to the incoming nucleotide at the alpha phosphate. And there's going to be a nucleophilic attack of the oxygen of the 3' hydroxyl on the alpha phosphate of the incoming nucleotide. Here you can see the incoming nucleotide nitrogenous base, the ribose sugar, and the triphosphate group. So that attack, that nucleophilic attack, then joins the alpha phosphate of the incoming nucleotide to the 3' oxygen of the previous nucleotide, and the phosphate groups, the inorganic phosphates are released. Now, there's a universal feature of DNA polymerases, and that is that there are magnesium ions present. And these magnesium ions are juxtaposed in such a way that one stabilizes the 3' oxygen on the last added nucleotide, which keeps it in its ionized form, negatively charged, and induces the attack on the alpha phosphate. And the other magnesium interacts with the phosphate groups and stabilizes them that are going to be leaving when this nucleophilic attack joins a new nucleotide to the growing primer strand. And the, in a way, you can visualize the protein, the polymerase domains of the protein, as existing to juxtapose these magnesium ions, these inorganic ions, in just the right place that allows the catalysis then of DNA polymerization, the joining of incoming nucleotides to an existing primer strand. So the positioning of these magnesium ions then facilitates the catalysis. And we can view then how those magnesium ions and the active site of the enzyme exist in the heart of the protein. There are three catalytic residues that are responsible for positioning these magnesiums, as well as an important water molecule. So there are two aspartates and one alanine whose oxygens chelate those magnesiums, as well as some water molecules involved. And that exists then right in the heart of the polymerase domain, that part of the enzyme. So this view of DNA polymerases is rather interesting, because you look at the protein then as a positioning device to position two inorganic magnesium ions in just the right spot to facilitate this nucleophilic attack that joins two nucleotides together in a growing DNA chain. So that ends our treatment of DNA replication. We'll be looking at the way that DNA information now, it doesn't serve to cause its own replication, but rather the way that DNA information is decoded in the cell to produce functional products encoded by genes. So we'll be looking at the central dogma of molecular biology, which describes information flow from DNA through RNA to protein. And that's what we'll be going with in our next lecture.